Okay, welcome everybody as we begin chapter 8 with the breaking of the seventh seal and the beginning of the seven trumpets. Last week we saw the common denominator of the sixth seal, the seventh trumpet, and the seven bowls, which were in some way all connected to wrath. But we must not forget that before wrath comes the great tribulation. The foolish virgins, they will probably face the great tribulation. However, upon repentance and receiving Yahusha HaMashiach as their savior and being fully committed to him, they will be spared from the wrath. Even if it is at 1 minute to midnight, there is still hope for those that do face the great tribulation, because some may go in it and have never even heard the gospel message. But in that time period, they will have that opportunity. So let's first listen to the reading of Revelation chapter 8, and then we'll proceed.
When the Lamb opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. Then I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets were given to them. And another angel came and stood at the altar with a golden censer, and he was given much incense to offer with the prayers of all the saints on the golden altar before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints rose before God from the hand of the angel. Then the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from the altar and threw it on the earth. And there were peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning, and earthquake. Now the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared to blow them. The first angel blew his trumpet, and there followed hail and fire mixed with blood, and these were thrown upon the earth. And a third of the earth was burned up, and a third of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. The second angel blew his trumpet, and something like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea, and a third of the sea became blood. A third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. The third angel blew his trumpet, and a great star fell from heaven, blazing like a torch. And it fell on a third of the rivers and on the springs of water. The name of the star is Wormwood. A third of the waters became wormwood, and many people died from the water because it had been made bitter. The fourth angel blew his trumpet, and a third of the sun was struck, and a third of the moon, and a third of the stars, so that a third of their light might be darkened, and a third of the day might be kept from shining, and likewise a third of the night. Then I looked, and I heard an eagle crying with a loud voice as it flew directly overhead.
Woe! Woe! Woe to those who dwell on the earth at the blast of the other trumpets that the three angels are about to blow!
So we presently are in the midst of much sorcery happening, and the time of Yahuwah being patient and loving and showing us much mercy is going to come to a close. And because his door will not always be open, and he told us that the end of days would be like the days of Noah, the days of Jared. And we most certainly are seeing those things happen. So as we start to get into our session tonight, I have a few video clips I want to show you because of the fact that we are in the midst of sorceries. Are you going to heed Yahusha's warning through the Ruach HaKodesh to come out of her, my people, lest you partake of her sins, as he rides on his white horse, holding the scroll with seven seals, our deed to be redeemed, as well as the land and all creation? Or will you follow the pharmacia, which means sorceries, the sorceries of men on earth, which we see practiced abundantly? Is your name, your very DNA that God created you with, is it registered in heaven? Have you received Yahusha HaMashiach as your Savior? Or is your name, again, equivalent to DNA, registered in the Tiberius tracking system interface to quantum computing, which is an actual computer system used to track and monitor those receiving the jab? Are people becoming transhuman? Or are they receiving Yahusha and becoming part of the one new man, Israel? So with that being said, I want us to watch this video clip, The Mark of the Beast, Pharmakia, which the very word pharmakia actually does mean sorceries.
Hi, I wanted to quickly share two clips with you from 2007 and 2008 that were sent to me by viewers, and I do this under the Fair Use Act. I think you will be surprised at the information contained in these, given that both clips are more than a decade old. Listen carefully to what is shared and then compare it with what is happening in the world right now. Are you ready? Here we go.
It was 10 years ago, just after the government instituted the whole isolation policy. We began hearing reports of a mass epidemic, some unknown disease sweeping the country. The details were vague at first, nothing on the cause or transmission of the disease, only that it was highly contagious, and in most cases, fatal. Before the general public even had time to react, the government declared a state of emergency and ordered a mandatory vaccination program. For our protection, they said. As it turns out, that was the beginning of our nightmare. The disease was a complete government fabrication, and the supposed vaccine they were injecting into everyone? In reality, it was a cyber virus developed by Daiwa. The virus has a mutating effect on the cells of the body. It alters their molecular structure and converts them into biometal, essentially turning us into machines from the inside out. There's no way to stop it. And to make things worse, the cybervirus was still early in its experimental phase.
What do you mean?
Daiwa didn't even know if it would work. It had never been tested on a large scale. So they turned Japan into their own private laboratory.
When it does work, the virus gradually progresses through the body until it finally reaches the brain. At that point, we become perfect androids under Daiwa's control. The speed of the process differs from person to person. Those of us who have yet to be fully assimilated, as best we can, we hold on to those fragments of our humanity that still remain. But even now, we can feel them slipping further and further away.
In the early 1990s, we realized that computers would get incredibly clever, and this would be a big threat unless we could actually figure out some way of keeping up with the machines. And the obvious way of keeping up with the machines is to be able to make a direct connection between our brains and the machine world. So we thought, well, you know, how can you do that? You can't stick a DIN socket into the back of your head. That isn't going to work very well. But then lots of people started talking about nanotechnology and self-replicating devices, and we thought, well, at some point in the distant future, you know, say 2030, 2040, who knows, you should be able to get an injection into your arm with a few nanotechnology devices which would wander up to your brain and start connecting to every single neuron. And there's enough address space, and even in IP version 6, the internet addressing system, you can address signals to every single neuron individually in your brain. In fact, every neuron in the entire planet, everybody's brain, you can send signals to. So we've got a means, in principle, of connecting electronic devices to every brain cell in your head. Therefore, you can take an exact replica of your brain, so I could have Ian Pearson Mark II living inside my PC in 2030, and I could have all of my thoughts backed up on there, all of my memories backed up, and if I get run down by a bus, it doesn't matter. It's not a career problem because I've got a backup on the network. So, you know, this is a wonderful concept for the future. We call it soul catcher, effectively capturing my entire mind and dumping it on a chip, well, notionally a chip, and I would have another existence in cyberspace. Unfortunately, a lot of the media have misunderstood. They thought we were doing this next year, but it's actually sort of 25, 30 years away, unless we get some very big breakthroughs in technology between now and then.
Well, I think we look 50 years out, we're going to have machines that are far more intelligent than we are as humans. So I don't know that I particularly like that scenario, machines making all the decisions for me. If we look to cyborgs, which is all about enhancing humans to create superhuman beings, then that gives us the possibility of taking some of that machine intelligence and linking it with our own, giving humans cyborg capabilities. That, I think, is a possibility that we're going to see either intelligent machines or cyborgs actually running things on Earth. Humans will be something like a subspecies, a bit like chimpanzees are at the moment. So if you're a human and you well, I don't want to be upgraded, well, that's your choice, but you're going to be a chimpanzee in the future.
I do have more examples in which similar information is shared with the masses that are fast asleep, blatantly spelling out to us our enemy's intent behind the global stab-in-the-arm program. I can specifically mention a series with the title of Utopia, in which this rabbit, which is at the head of this program in this series, once again features throughout the 8 episodes. I would also like to ask you that if you are aware of any other examples in which similar information to what was just shown is shared, please send me the links and I will do my best to put together a more comprehensive example of how humanity's enemy has been showing us their plans in plain sight. But most do not want to believe it, or are simply not aware of it and are then caught in the enemy's snare. Share this with others before they too fall for the deception.
So that animated clip he began that video with was done back in, I believe he said 2008, 2010. So they've had this capability for a while, and probably much longer than that. In Genesis 6, we read, "The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of Elohim came in to the daughters of men, and they bore children to them. Those were the mighty men who were of old, the men of name. And Yahuwah saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And Yahuwah was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. And Yahuwah said, I am going to wipe off man whom I have created from the face of the ground, both man and beast, creeping creature and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of Yahuwah." Make no mistake, Satan presently rules this world. There is only one way out, and that is through faith in Yahusha HaMashiach, Jesus of Nazareth. Unless you are washed by the blood of the Lamb, thereby being born anew, you cannot enter the kingdom of Elohim. This world is feeding the sheeple, smoke and mirrors, and many are being deceived and are going as a lamb unto the slaughter.
Hello, this is Nicholson 1968. Hope you're doing well. This video was a no-brainer for me. Wow, I mean, it was like a setup right down my alley. So the basis for this video was based on Taylor Swift's Are You Ready For It? And so what I did was I watched the video, and I was going to try to do a breakdown of it. And you know what, I'm not going to spend all of my time doing that, and I don't want to subject you to it or whatever as far as, you know, step-by-step breaking it down. But what I did was I took that video, which is telling you a story about ascending another way. It's about transhumanism and the old technology fading away of the alchemist magician that trying to discover the elixir, the philosopher's stone, to try to live forever another way. That was the old technology, the old alchemist, wizardry, that kind of thing. The new thing is technology, transhuman, trying to live another way. It's just repackaged. That's basically what the video, are you ready for it? And that's the other thing, is the secret societies and the Illuminati, whatever you want to call them, behind these videos, the lyrics are telling you a story which has nothing to do with the video. They're telling you two different stories at the same time. So some people are going to get it, some people are not. The majority are not going to get it. What I did was I just didn't want to just break that down for you. You know me, I try to take it a little step further. I blended it with Westworld, the TV show, which is a TV show about rich people that come into a world, Westworld, where there's a land full of AIs that look real, feel real. They get to pay $40,000 a day to interact in a Westworld, in an AI world, that they can have sex with the AI, they can shoot, kill them. There's do what thou will, you know, goes back to Jay-Z, you know, Aleister Crowley, do what thou will, you know, so there's no consequences for your action. So I took that, mixed it with it, as well as Ghost in the Shell, which is another story, a movie with Scarlett Johansson, that is telling you a story as well of where we're going. Is what do you think a ghost in the shell is? And those that take transhumanism in the future to upgrade yourself from your present human state, you will be a ghost in a shell. You will be controlled. And it will be sold to you like it is the best thing on the planet at the time. So I took Ghost in the Shell, Westworld, Taylor Swift's Are You Ready For It, and I remixed it. But before I play that for you, I want to go over something with you and show you something, how the elites communicate and how they portray a message to each other without writing anything down obvious or speaking it, like I spoke on my last video, Parallels, See the Big Picture. So as you look on the cover of Taylor Swift's Reputation CD, which the single Are You Ready For It is off of this new album releasing, Reputation. A couple of things are pretty obvious for those that are awake. You've got the black and the white Masonic symbolism. You have her eye, one eye symbolism covered up with newspaper. So you might ask, what has newspaper got to do with anything? Well, it is a code. It is a symbolism for something. And it is a symbolism for Freemasonic. And I'll tell you why. I'll show you. In every Masonic lodge, this right here is a Masonic tracing board. It is in every Masonic lodge, some form or fashion, they have a picture of this. Notice that at the top is east, not north. On a compass, up at the top is north, due north, not in a Masonic lodge. The altar always faces east.
So there's three, with one missing, it looks like. Is this the north, south, west, and the east is missing, or?
No, that would be the east.
That would be the east?
Because that's north.
Right.
Right. I don't know why that is missing, actually.
I asked him why there were only three lights at the altar, and he said he wasn't too sure why, but there are three because one represents the east, one represents the west, one represents the south. But in Masonry, the north is the place of darkness. And of course, according to the Bible tells us that the north is where God resides.
God is from the north. The Creator is from the north. The altar is not facing him. It's facing east, where man was thrown out of the garden. Where does that come from? Genesis 3:24. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubs and flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the Tree of Life. And that's what's really going on here, is basically trying to get back in the Garden of Eden another way. But also notice back to the tracing board, when you read from left to right, you have N-E-W-S, news, and it is code. Because if you read it on a compass, it doesn't read correctly from left to right. Only in the Masonic tracing board or in a Masonic lodge do you get that reference from left to right, N-E-W-S, news. So just wanted to point that out. And also, it was also in one of the Olympics a couple of years ago, the stage was newspaper. And they also had an octopus as one of the mascots used in that show. Tentacles everywhere, the symbolism of the octopus having reaching out all over the world. Same thing. It's putting a stamp out there of we're in control of this artist, Taylor Swift. We're letting you know, we have her, what she's doing, her videos she's putting out, gorgeous, look what you made me do. And now this one. I mean, it's pretty much riding in a row telling you something. Look what you made me do. Are you ready for it, gorgeous? I mean, that's pretty much telling you how they use the titles to tell you a story separately of what's going on. So, lastly, before I play the video, there's three versions of this CD. There's the standard, there's a special version volume 2. Notice that the numbers that are used in the special versions is 72. Now, anybody that's followed or seen any of my videos, I've told you that the pyramid on the back of your dollar bill is an uncompleted temple. Eye of Lucifer, Horus, whatever you want to say, on the back of your U.S. dollar bill. So 72 is code word for 666. Depending on who you ask, they'll understand. And what I mean by that is 66 add a 6. The world teaches you 66 add a 6, you get 72. Ask someone in the know, Freemasonry, a 33rd degree Mason, ask him 66 add a 6. He'll tell you 666. He'll just add the 6. The statement is the same. The question is the same. 66 add a 6. But the way you're taught to look at it and perceive it, you get a whole different answer. So it's no accident that they've used 72 on her special versions of these other CDs. And it has to do with the temple. It has to do with what the very secret, the inner sanctum of Freemasonry is about. Building human temples. Building a stairway to heaven, another way other than the way we've been shown. And, you know, for you guys who think I'm grasping at straws and saying, Nicholson, you're just seeing what you want to see, I'm going to show you just a little quick example of why I'm telling you it's all around you. You just got to look for it. And they're telling you. And this is a perfect example. Remember the perfume commercial a couple of years ago with Julia Roberts? Notice she's walking into the room. She's in white. Everybody else is in black. There you go, the Masonic black and white. Everybody is connected from above. That's what the Freemasons are above. They want to disconnect from the Creator. They want to do it their way. They don't want to answer to a Creator. They want to break free. There you go, breaking free from that. And they want to, look, she's going up the stairs. She's ascending another way. She does not want to be like the rest of everybody else. That's what you just saw in a little quick perfume commercial right in front of your eyes that most don't see. So, remember what I told you in the garden? They believe Lucifer freed them from the evil Creator that is controlling us from above, and they want to break free. So, I hope you enjoy this video remix. It's a lot of little information, quick information in here that I remixed it for you. I hope you enjoy it. I hope you share it for those out there that are still asleep. They don't get it. People are just, you know, they're looking at other things and being distracted. But this is really the one game. And you better be ready for it. No pun intended.
You can't play God without being acquainted with the devil. The problem, Bernard, is that what you and I do is so complicated. We practice witchcraft. We speak the right words. And we create life itself out of chaos.
Sadly, that is where we're at That is clearly where we are at without going into much more detail. And we don't need to dwell on what the enemy is doing. We do need to be aware of what the enemy is doing, advocating another way, which there is not another way, and advocating eternal life, but going to end up having a lot of people wanting to die, but they cannot. So we begin Revelation chapter 8. We're going to be looking at the seventh seal, the golden censer, the seven trumpets, the three woes, and so much more. In Revelation 8:1 through 8:5, and when he opened the seventh seal, there came to be silence in the heaven for about half an hour. And I saw the seven messengers who stand before Elohim, and to them were given seven trumpets. And another messenger came and stood at the slaughter place holding a golden censer, and much incense was given to him that he should offer it with the prayers of all the set apart ones upon the golden slaughter place, which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the set apart ones went up before Elohim from the hand of the messenger. And the messenger took the censer and filled it with fire from the slaughter place and threw it to the earth. And there were noises and thunders and lightnings and an earthquake. So we read that there was silence in heaven for about one half hour. And in an Adam Clark commentary, he wrote, "There is here and in the following verses a strong allusion to different parts of the temple worship, a presumption that the temple was still standing and the regular service of Elohim carried on. The silence here refers to this fact. While the priest went in to burn incense in the holy place, all the people continued in silent mental prayer without till the priest returned. The angel mentioned here appears to execute the office of priest, as we shall by and by see. In Hebrews 9:2, we read, "For a tent was prepared," and that was talking about the time of the wilderness, the wandering in the wilderness, and the tabernacle in the wilderness. "For a tent was prepared, the first part in which was the lampstand and the table and the showbread, which is called the set apart place. And after the second veil, the part of the tent, which is called most set apart, to which belong the golden censer and the Ark of the Covenant, overlaid on all sides with gold, in which were the golden pot that held the manna, and the rod of Aaron that budded, and the tablets of the covenant. And above it, the cherubim of esteem were overshadowing the place of atonement, about which we do not now speak in detail. And these having been prepared like this, the priests always went into the first part of the tent, accomplishing the services. But into the second part, the high priest went alone once a year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the sins of ignorance of the people. Set apart spirits signifying this, that the way into the most set apart place was not yet made manifest while the first tent has a standing, which was a parable for the present time in which both gifts and slaughters are offered, which are unable to perfect the one serving as to his conscience, only as to foods and drinks and different washings and fleshly regulations imposed until a time of setting matters straight. And that until a time came with Yahusha HaMashiach, who serves as our high priest after the order of Melchizedek." We read in Numbers 15, verse 28. "And the priest shall make atonement for the being who strays by mistake, when he sins by mistake before Yahuwah, to make atonement for him, and it shall be forgiven him. For him who does whatever by mistake, there is one Torah, both for him who is native among the children of Israel and for the stranger who sojourns in their midst. But the being who does whatever defiantly, whether he is a native or a stranger, he reviles Yahuwah, and that being shall be cut off from among his people. So the golden censer was also called the fire holder in the Old Testament, if you will, in Leviticus 16, and it's tied to the Day of Atonement. In Leviticus 16, 12 through 14, it reads, "And shall take a fire holder filled with burning coals of fire from the slaughter place before Yahuwah, with his hands filled with sweet incense beaten fine, and shall bring it inside the veil. And he shall put the incense on the fire before Yahuwah, and the cloud of incense shall cover the lid of atonement, which is on the witness, lest he die. And he shall take some of the blood of the bull and sprinkle it with his finger on the lid of atonement on the east side, also in front of the lid of atonement. He sprinkles some of the blood with his finger seven times." And it's also mentioned as another example in Numbers 16, verse 46. "So Moses said to Aaron, take the fire holder and put fire in it from the slaughter place and lay incense on and go, hurry to the congregation and make atonement for them. For wrath has come out from Yahuwah. The plague has begun." So we see different examples of this fire holder, which equates to the golden censer we read about in Revelation. And please forgive me for misspelling censer. I guess that was just something that I happened to spell incorrectly because of the days we live in. What can I say? There is another censorship on my mind. Okay, so there was silence for about one half hour. And then later on, we read about the hour has come. The throwing down of the golden censer, as I understand, equates to the beginning of the Great Tribulation. The Great Tribulation will last 42 months. Therefore, those that have heeded Yahusha's call to come out of her, my people, in the first 42 months will, in my understanding, be spared from the hour of trial. We read about the foolish virgins and wise virgins, and these are just a couple of examples. We know out of the seven assemblies addressed that Yahusha addressed in Revelation 2 and 3, five of them needed to make some adjustments and corrections and repentance. And one of those was Sardis. In Revelation 3:3, we read, "Remember then how you have received and heard, and watch and repent. If then you do not wake up, I shall come upon you as a thief, and you shall not know at all what hour I come upon you." And the two assemblies that had no condemnation, which would be groupings of wise virgins, we read an account about the assembly of Philadelphia. "Because you have guarded my word of endurance, I also shall guard you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon all the world to try those who dwell on the earth." So who are the wise virgins we will be reading about in the book of Revelation, and some we have already read about? And I just listed those here. For instance, the two witnesses, they are definitely wise virgins. They could represent the assemblies of Smyrna and Philadelphia, which are the two lampstands led by the Spirit, as with Moses and Elijah, the two olive trees. And we know that Philadelphia was a grouping of wise virgins because they would be guarded from the hour of trial. They had no condemnation. Neither did Smyrna have condemnation but Smyrna will have a direct confrontation with Satan and be thrown into prison for 10 days. But we read in Revelation 2:10, it says, "Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer," speaking to the assembly of Smyrna. "See, the devil is about to throw some of you in prison in order to try you, and you shall have pressure 10 days. Be trustworthy until death, and I shall give you the crown of life." And also we read in Revelation chapter 12, verse 17, "And the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to fight with the remnant of her seed, those guarding the commands of Elohim and possessing the witness of Yahusha Messiah." So could that be connected to the assembly that made up Smyrna? Very possibly, because we see direct confrontation with the dragon, Satan, both in Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, and Revelation 12, verse 17. And then lastly, another example of the wise virgins would be the 144,000 that witness to the foolish virgins and those that have never known Yahusha in that hour of trial during the Great Tribulation. Now, I ran across this excerpt that seemed to kind of summarize things well, so I went ahead and made a copy of it to share with you all, and I'll leave the link in the description section below. So it says, "John saw another angel having a golden censer who came and stood at the altar. He was given much incense that he should offer it with the prayers of all the saints. Then the angel took the censer, filled it with fire from the altar, and threw it to the earth." The context of this verse is right after the sealing of the 144,000 and just before the beginning of the seven trumpets. So that seventh seal has been broken. So now we're transitioning to seeing the angel with the golden censer and the beginning of the seven trumpets. And it's stating that we need to remember that the 144,000 have already been sealed. John had already seen four angels holding back the four winds of the earth in Revelation 7:1. The four winds represent the destruction and chaos that Satan is allowed to bring about during the time of trouble. And he is not permitted to do this until the 144,000 have been sealed on their foreheads. The golden censer is another symbol of this protection. In the Old Testament sanctuary service, the high priest on the Day of Atonement took a censer with incense with him into the most holy place. It gave off a cloud of smoke, veiling him from the direct glory of Elohim, lest he die. The censer was thus an instrument of intermediary protection. The censer as a symbol of protection is also seen in the story of the rebellion of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram during the wilderness wanderings. They had challenged Moses' authority, gained many followers, and as a result, a deadly plague broke out in the camp. So Moses said to Aaron, "Take a censer and put fire in it from the altar, put incense on it, and take it quickly to the congregation and make atonement for them, for wrath has gone out from Yahuwah. The plague has begun." Then Aaron took it as Moses commanded and ran into the midst of the assembly. So he put in the incense and made atonement for the people. And he stood between the dead and the living. So the plague was stopped. Yahuwah has agreed to allow Satan a short period of time, the time of trouble, in which to bring about chaos and destruction in an attempt to prove that Elohim's special messengers, the 144,000, will not remain true to him. He is given exactly 42 months. The 144,000 will be partially protected by Elohim, but Satan will have full access to the rest of humanity, and he will attempt to prevent anyone from leaving Babylon and joining the 144,000 on Elohim's side. His attempts will begin as he incites a world war that is depicted in the seven trumpets. The war starts when the four angels release the four winds, also symbolized by the throwing down of the golden censer. So, contrary to the teaching of many commentators, the throwing down of the censer has not already happened at some time in the past. It does not mark the closing of probation, and it does not mean that Yahusha will no longer intercede for his people. It simply marks the beginning of the Great Tribulation, and that's also how I see it. Now, some of you may have some different perspectives, but that's also how I see it. So the throwing down of the censer marks the beginning of the Great Tribulation. Okay, the seven trumpets, verse 6 and 7. And the seven messengers who held the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. And the first messenger sounded, and there came to be hail and fire mixed with blood, and they were thrown to the earth. And a third of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. The trumpets begin what appears to mirror in many ways the plagues of Egypt. For instance, in Exodus 9, we read of the plague of hail. So we see that great turmoil is starting to begin. The Great Tribulation, in my understanding right here, is starting to begin with the casting down of the golden censer and the first trumpet being blown. And this hail is mixed with fire and with blood, which is different than the hail mentioned in the first Exodus plagues. And then also in Psalms 148:8, we read, fire and hail, snow and clouds, stormy wind that does his work. All creation responds to Yahuwah. We may not understand how that happens, but his creation knows who he is. Even the rocks cried out at his crucifixion. And the second messenger sounded, and what looked like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea, and a third of the sea became blood, and a third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. Again, Exodus 7 correlates to waters turning to blood and the fish dying, creating a great stench. So we see again a similarity of plagues with the waters becoming blood and living creatures in the sea dying. And here, in addition, we see a third of the ships were destroyed. And this is on a greater scale. This is on a grander scale than the time of the first Exodus, as we read in Exodus 7. Thus said Yahuwah, by this you know that I am Yahuwah. See, I'm striking the waters which are in the river with the rod that is in my hand, and they shall be turned to blood, and the fish in the river shall die, and the river shall stink, and the Mitzrites, the Egyptians, shall find it impossible to drink the water of the river. And Yahuwah spoke to Moses, say to Aaron, take your rod and stretch out your hand over the waters of Egypt, over their streams, over their rivers, over their ponds, and over all their pools of water, that they become blood. And there shall be blood in all the land of Egypt, both in wooden and in stone containers. And Moses and Aaron did so, as Yahuwah commanded. And he lifted up the rod and struck the waters that were in the river, in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of his servants. And all the waters that were in the river were turned to blood, and the fish that were in the river died, and the river stank. And the Mitzrites, the Egyptians, were unable to drink the water of the river, and the blood was in all the land of Egypt. So that was horrendous. But the Great Tribulation is going to be more horrendous. And we see that with just the first messenger blowing their trumpet and the second messenger sounding their trumpet as well. And the third messenger sounded, and a great star fell from the heaven, burning like a torch, and it fell on a third of the rivers and on the fountains of water. And the name of the star is called Wormwood. And a third of the waters became wormwood. And many men died from the waters because they were made bitter. So ponder, does this star, Wormwood, correlate to Satan being cast out of heaven? You know, I pondered that because next we will see a third of the stars darkened. And so I wonder, you know, for many years, I thought it was totally separate and apart from Satan being cast out of heaven. I'll leave it up to all of you to continue to study that to see what you think. And in verse 12, and the fourth messenger sounded, and a third of the sun was struck, and a third of the moon, and a third of the stars, so that a third of them were darkened, and a third of the day did not shine, and likewise the night. So again, a lot of similarities of these plagues coming upon the earth as were in the first Exodus. So if the large burning star that's called Wormwood and the darkened stars do not correlate to Satan and the fallen angels, then they could literally be stars. And I looked, and I heard an eagle flying in mid-heaven, crying with a loud voice, "Woe, woe, woe to those dwelling upon the earth because of the remaining blast of the trumpet of the three messengers who are about to sound." The fifth, sixth, and seventh trumpets equate to the three woes. The fifth trumpet woe correlates to Revelation 9, 1 through 12. We'll see the pit open. We'll see locusts. We'll see Abaddon. The sixth trumpet woe correlates to Revelation 9, 13 through 21, Revelation 11, 7 through 14, where four messengers released to kill a third of mankind. And we also see in those scriptures, the two witnesses witness for 42 months, then are killed and raised and called up to heaven. And the seventh trumpet woe is recorded in Revelation 11, 14 through 19. And it's stating that Yah's wrath has come, and it's time for the dead to be judged. It's time for the rewards to be given to the prophets and set apart ones. And then Revelation 15, 1 and verse 6 and 8, bold judgments, following Revelation 16 with the wrath being poured out. So again, with the fifth trumpet, we do see the locusts. And the sixth trumpet, we see a lot of death. Again, there's a connection to the first Exodus because there was a plague of locusts, and also there was death of the firstborn. So we see correlations. They're different. They're on a larger scale, but we see the similarities. So as I was preparing this, I had a question. Do the three trumpet woes equal the three messengers of Revelation 14? It is very possible they do, based on that chiastic structure we've been looking at and following as we go through the book of Revelation, and the fact that in Revelation 15, the bold judgments begin. And it is the seventh trumpet that announces his wrath has come. And it's just before the wrath, however, the final harvest of the great tribulation occurs. Because in Revelation 14, 6, it's also talking about three messengers. And we've already seen that the three messenger angels with the trumpets that are connected with the fifth, sixth, and seventh trumpets are the woes. So I'm posing the question, could those same three angels also have these final messages as they are also sounding their trumpets? Because this in Revelation 15, it flows into the beginning of the bowl judgments. So as far as timing goes, it does seem like they could be the same. In Revelation 14, 6, and 7, we read, "And I saw another messenger flying in mid heaven, holding the everlasting good news to announce to those dwelling on the earth, even to every nation and tribe and tongue and people." Everybody's going to have that opportunity to receive the covenant confirming gospel message, saying with a loud voice, "Fear Elohim and give esteem to him, because the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made the heaven and the earth and sea and fountains of water." He is the creator. He's the creator of the universe. And if these messengers correlate, I mean, this message is very important, because the pit has just been opened. The locust has come out, and they have a king over them, and his name is Abaddon. So then in Revelation 14:8, we see, "And another messenger followed, saying, Babel is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her whoring." And if it does equate to the angel with the sixth trumpet, that's when the four messengers are released to kill a third of mankind. And of course, the two witnesses witness for 42 months, then are killed and raised and called to heaven. Then lastly, the third messenger followed them, saying with a loud voice, "If anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark upon his forehead or upon his hand, he also shall drink of the wine of the wrath of Elohim." Notice that phrase, wrath of who? Wrath of Elohim, which is poured out undiluted into the cup of his wrath. "And he shall be tortured with fire and sulfur before the set apart messengers and before the Lamb. And the smoke of their torture goes up forever and ever. And they have no rest day or night, those worshiping the beast and his image. Also, if anyone receives the mark of his name." Here is the endurance of the set apart ones. Here are those guarding the commands of Elohim and the belief of Yahusha. "And I heard a voice out of the heavens saying to me, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Master from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, in order that they rest from their labors and their works follow with them." During this time, it is so bad that this third messenger is saying, "Blessed are the dead who die in the Master from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, in order that they rest from their labors and their works follow with them." This is an horrendous time. Just with what we have covered a tremendous amount of information. And I just wanted, when I was preparing this, I saw this possible connection between the last three trumpet angels and possibly the three messengers in Revelation 14, as does our chiastic structure have a correlation to them as well? Are they the same? Are they different? I'm just posing that question for all of you to ponder. Now, for a general perspective, I just want us to look at all these unfolding events and how they may look like in the last 7 years. Now, this is just a chart to help us kind of hold on to all of this information and all this stuff that's happening and put it in a way that we can kind of assimilate it and also be able to communicate. Well, you know, if I show you what I'm seeing, and be sure to mute your mics, if I show you what I'm kind of putting together, then you'll have a place to start with a different perspective or maybe stand in agreement. But last week we had this last 7 year tribulation time period placed in it like a chiastic structure. And I shared with all of you how I see Yahusha riding on the white horse in the first 3.5 years, the time of tribulation, but it's not great tribulation. Matter of fact, I kind of see us having entered that, correlating it with the Abraham Accord, the signing that will of the covenant that will be broken in the midst of the week, Daniel 9:27. So I see the first 3.5 years as tribulation, but not great tribulation. And we also see that the enemy is also rising up, cloaked in white, if you will. The enemy always counterfeits. And the enemy also wants to record and build a different kind of temple. He wants to take over the DNA, the created being made by Yahuwah. He wants to overtake their bodies and make them transhuman, as we just saw in those video clips. I possibly see the red horse riding right here at the beginning, shortly after the casting down of the golden censer. And with after that horrendous world war, there's going to be famine, and there's going to be death, and there's going to be, he destroys incredibly. So we see all the souls under the altar saying, how long, Elohim, until you revenge our blood? And he tells them, until those others that are still on earth are killed as you were. So remember, that's the fifth seal. And so there's still a pause until the final 2,520 days are done. So now we have a golden censer being cast down. Now we have a correlation of the golden censer being connected to the Day of Atonement. So where would that be on such a timeline, if you will, for the last 2,520 days? And I would put that at the Day of Atonement, right before Satan is cast out of heaven. And with the golden censer being cast down, then the great tribulation begins. And also at the end, on the Day of Atonement, judgment, that's when the wrath of the Lamb is going to break forth. There will still be people being saved during the Great Tribulation. And as I understand it, the 144,000 will be witnessing to those that are living through the Great Tribulation. They have until the very last Day of Atonement. So as I prepared for our session tonight, I had a question to pose to everybody. Is the wrath of the Lamb the same as the wrath of Elohim? If they're separate, when do they occur? We read in Revelation 6, 15 through 17, and the sovereigns of the earth and the great ones and the rich ones and the commanders and the mighty and every slave and every free one hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him sitting on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, because the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand? And then in Revelation verse 20, 7 through 10, and also in that scripture I read earlier as well, we read, "And when the 1,000 years have ended, Satan shall be released from his prison, and he shall go out to lead the nations astray, which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together for battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. And they came up over the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the set apart ones and the beloved city. And fire came down from Elohim out of the heaven and consumed them. And the devil who led them astray, who was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet are. And they shall be tortured day and night forever and ever." So in my understanding, the wrath of the Lamb occurs at the end of the Great Tribulation prior to the 1,000-year reign. We rule and reign with him 1,000 years from Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, hovering above the defiled earth. This is the great ensign, in my understanding, this great banner for all to see, hovering above the earth. And why do I think it's hovering above the earth? A great reason is in Revelation 20, verse 9, that is on the screen that I just read. Because after Satan is released for 1,000 years, he gathers all the nations, puts them in battle formation, whose number is as the sand of the sea. And what do? They come up over the breadth of the earth and surround the camp of the set apart ones. So wait a second. So the camp of the set apart ones are up over the breadth of the earth. Okay, so they must be in a place hovering the New Jerusalem over the defiled earth, because the earth is still defiled, and it wouldn't be landed on the earth since the earth is still defiled. And it goes on to define it. It's surrounded the camp of the set apart ones and the beloved city, the city, the new city of Jerusalem. And of course, Elohim doesn't tolerate that anymore, because Satan has been grounded. He no longer has permission to come up before Elohim. No, he's been cast out. And just like Nadab and Abihu, who brought strange fire in their fire holders before Elohim, were consumed, this is what will happen to Satan and those of the nations that are numbered as the sand of the sea. Yahuwah is a consuming fire. This will be so fast, they won't even know what hit them. So the wrath of Elohim, the consuming fire, in my understanding, occurs at the end of the 1,000-year reign prior to a renewed heaven and earth. Now, I understand there are some views that do not see the 1,000-year reign being 1,000 years. I most definitely do see it being 1,000 years, just as we've been counting the 6,000 years to the point that we're at, and we're fixing to roll over into the 7th millennium. So there's micro views of the 7 days, and there's macro views of the 7 days equating to 7,000 years. So what happened after this last day of atonement of the last 7 years, the 2,520 days? What happens after the last day of atonement, that judgment time period that I have circled in the box? I want us to focus for a moment where the Great Tribulation ends and the wrath on the Lamb begins. "And the seventh messenger sounded, and there came to be loud voices in the heaven, saying the reign of this world has become the reign of our master and of his Messiah, and he shall reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders sitting before Elohim on their thrones fell on their faces and worshiped Elohim, saying, we give you thanks, O Yahweh El Shaddai, the one who is and who was and who is coming, because you have taken your great power and reigned. And the nations were enraged, and your wrath has come, and the time of the dead to be judged, and to give the reward to your servants, the prophets, and to the set apart ones, and to those who fear your name, small and great, and to destroy those who destroy the earth. And the dwelling place of Elohim was opened in the heaven, and the ark of his covenant was seen in his dwelling place. And there came to be lightnings and voices and thunders and an earthquake and great hail. In Revelation chapter 20, 4 and 5, we read, and I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was given to them. And the lives of those who had been beheaded because of the witness they bore to Yahusha and because of the word of Elohim, and who did not worship the beast nor his image and did not receive his mark upon their foreheads or upon their hands. And they lived and reigned with Messiah for 1,000 years. This is the first resurrection. In verse 5, we see a statement in parentheses that goes on to say, and the rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. So this is just a closer view of what might be going on at the close of the 2,520 days. This is just a sample from the end of the Great Tribulation to the end of the 1,000-year reign. In Deuteronomy, and we have to understand the components of a Jewish wedding, if you will. So we have to also keep that in mind, because that plays an intricate role when you're studying the book of Revelation. In Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 5, when a man has taken a new wife, let him not go out into the army, nor let any matter be imposed upon him. He shall be exempt 1 year for the sake of his home, to rejoice with his wife whom he has taken. And in the bottom right-hand corner about the wedding process, the pinnacle of this joyful celebration was the marriage supper. It was much more than just a sit-down dinner for all the guests. It included 7 full days of food, music, dance, and celebration. After the festivities, the husband was free to bring his bride to their new home to live together as husband and wife in the full covenant of marriage. If we're looking at the last day of atonement, that would end the 2,520 days. And just prior to that, we had that fifth seal going on because the souls of the martyred saints were crying out beneath his altar, how long, Elohim, shall you not revenge our blood? And he said, until others also had to die as they did. So the Great Tribulation had not been completed then. And then the Day of Atonement, the Day of Judgment, had come. We know after the Day of Atonement, we know the Feast of Tabernacles begins 5 days after the Day of Atonement, when we will tabernacle with our groom, and the 1,000-year sabbatical Sukkot with his bride begins, and the New Jerusalem, Mount Zion, hovers above the defiled earth still during this time period. Why do I say it's still, it would be hovering? Because during this 1,000-year reign, and I just put this here and just envision it as the last year of the 1,000-year reign, okay? So during this 1,000-year reign, Satan is imprisoned in chains. And when he's released at the end of this 1,000-year reign, that's when he comes up over the breadth of the earth to make war with the set apart ones in the new city of Jerusalem. And so for that reason, that's why I have it set up this way. And we know that Yahusha is going to return for us on the third day. Well, the third day equates to the seventh millennium, because he came 2,000 years prior. So from that point, it's been 2 days, if you will, or 2,000 years, and he's going to come on the third day. You can also equate it to him coming on the seventh day. If you start from the very beginning of creation in Genesis, so he would come on the seventh day. And that was depicted by when he went to the wedding at Canaan and he turned how many jugs of water into wine? 6 jugs of water into wine, which represented 6,000 years. And the seventh year is that 1 year of exemption that he has to rule and reign with his people. That would lead to the eighth great day. So from the ending of the 2,520 days to the last year of the 1,000-year reign, we see that the Jubilee is announced on the Day of Atonement of the seventh year, but would begin on the first day of the next year, which would be Abib 1. So the 1,000-year reign ends the seventh millennium as we enter the eighth great day on the first day of Abib. So it's just a general possibility as how it may look. In Hosea chapter 6, verse 2, it says, after 2 days, he shall revive us. When? On the third day, which equates to the seventh millennium. He shall raise us up so that we live before him. The third day equals also the sixth millennium going into the seventh millennium. The same holds true for the seventh day. The seventh day equals the beginning of the seventh millennium. So I know that can get pretty confusing. I know it can be things that we have to go back and look at and maybe draw your own chart so you can plot all these things that are happening. But without graphics, without plotting them on paper, it's going to be very difficult to make sure you've covered every event that's taking place and you've correlated it to his Moedim, because he moves and acts on his Moedim. And he's given us some specific time periods. You know, the two witnesses will witness for 42 months, 1,260 days. Satan will have 42 months to do his thing. And so we have to take all of this into consideration. And we also have to tie in and consider what's happening from what we've learned in the book of Daniel. And we don't need to lose sight also of the 2300 day timeline. So there's a lot of things going on, and we can do our best. A lot of this is speculation on how we're seeing the scriptures unfold and how we are growing and being sanctified as we study his word. And each time you go through Revelation, you're going to pick up something different, or you're going to view something different. But we are hungering and thirsting for his word. And he does honor that. And he does bless that. So with that being said, we're going to look at chapter 9 next week, which we will see the first woe unfold as the fifth angel blows and sounds the trumpet. So with that, we'll close and we'll take Q&A.